Hi and welcome to an episode of Challenge Rachel. This time it's the Coconut Collaborative Edition. Collaborative make yogurts and little dessert pots out of coconut, and they sent me a rather wide selection of their products and said, see what you can make out of those. They've sent me a few packs of their little pots, which I'm thinking are probably kind of little goopy, delicious, creamy type desserts. And I've got salted caramel and chocolate, banoffee, and praline and chocolate. And then I've got some of their natural yogurt, vanilla yogurt, and then most importantly for today's recipe, mango and passion fruit yogurt. And that is what we're gonna use today. They've also sent me a rather lovely notebook so I can hatch more dastardly plans. Today's recipe is gonna be a mango and passion fruit yogurt panna cotta that I will set with agar instead of gelatin, because gelatin's made from animals, so I can't eat that. I bought these powders a while back with the plan of making a casing for vegan sausages, making the sausage and then dunking them in this. Never got around to that. But when I was sort of thinking through this recipe, I suddenly remembered that I had them. Now, this is calcium lactate and this is sodium alginate. And I'm gonna do some molecular gastronomy. So I'm gonna make some grapefruit juice caviar, pearl type things. So it'll be a little fruity topping to go on the panna cotta. Never done this before, so I'm kind of excited, a bit geeked out over it. It should be a bit fun. To give you a very, very rudimentary explanation of how these work. So the alginate that's made, it's like an algae extract. I'm gonna put this in with the grapefruit juice and that creates a sort of gel. And then the calcium, it affects the ions. I haven't fully understood it yet, but that's a kind of basic explanation, and it sets the gel without needing to heat it. So I'm going to make a water bath with the calcium, put the alginate in with the juice. If you don't happen to have these in your cupboard, I have seen somebody using agar on the liquid and then dropping it into oil, and that does effectively the same thing. I've also had a slightly bizarre idea of making apple pie spaghetti. I'm gonna do baked apple spaghetti using apple puree baked with some spices. Alginate that, gel it, do it into strands, and then use the salted caramel pots to make ice cream, and then sprinkle maybe some maple syrup granola over the top of it. It's gonna be bonkers, but why not? It'll still be tasty, I think. The first step is to juice the grapefruit, because I'm gonna blend the alginate into it and it's going to create lots of bubbles, which I then need to remove and let it settle, so it needs a while in the fridge. I'm going to strain the juice because I don't want any of the pulp in there, and I'm just going to scrape the juice through the sieve there. Juiced all of my grapefruit. I've got 284 mils, which is it's a cup and 2 tablespoons. I would really strongly recommend getting some scales when you're doing the molecular stuff, because it does need to be a bit exact. And to jazz it up, I'm going to add some rose water, which is kind of distilled rose petals. It just has a really lovely fragrance that goes beautifully with grapefruit. I've got some vanilla bean paste here, which I'm going to pop in just a little bit. It's a very sticky, gloopy, highly scented and delicious stuff. I'm going to pour a tiny bit out and try it with some black pepper, just to see what that's like, whether it's worth adding in. To give it a bit of complexity. Yeah, I'm gonna put just a touch. So maybe it's literally a tiny pinch. Measuring the alginate does need sort of some precision, really. So I've got my tiny little scales out. I'm gonna do 3 grams, a teaspoonful. Let's see how much that weighs. Not far off. I'm going to start the blender and then add the alginate as it's going. I just think that's probably going to be better. So you can see that the gelling has kind of started already. So I'm going to stick this in the fridge and let it settle a bit. That's it in the fridge. So we'll check on it in about an hour or so. To give you a bit of reassurance if you're thinking I don't really want to put chemicals in my food. That is fair enough, but this is what they use in Gaviscon, So it kind of makes it thick and gloopy and helps with the suspension. And then this is what they use to fortify some foods with. So it's a type of salt, I believe. I think I've got that right. And I'm trying to research some electrolyte drinks and what I can make. And I think I can put that in. So yeah, I have 100 mils of soy milk. I'm adding that to the pan, start that warming through. This is 100 mils of cold water, and that's what I'm gonna mix the agar into. And I need 3/4 of a teaspoon of the agar powder. So I'm gonna do a half and a quarter. Whisk that together. Add the agar into the milk. Agar is another gelling agent that's made out of seaweed. You can also use carrageenan. I'm gonna heat this up and then let it come to a boil, and it needs to boil for about a minute to activate the agar. So that's been on for about a minute or so. Oh yeah, definitely stir it. I feel it sticking on the bottom. I've got my little glass dishes here that I'm going to use with the molds, and then turn it out like that. I'm just putting a bit of oil on a paper towel and smearing it. This has had probably another minute, 2 minutes maybe. So I'm going to decant the yogurt into a bowl just to make it a bit easy to mix everything in. Flavour's nice and subtle, not too artificial, because some fruit yogurts can just taste very fake, whereas this is nice and subtle, and it doesn't taste like coconut, which I'm kind of surprised at. I'm going to put in a bit of coconut sugar. I've not actually tried this before, but it's got like a brown sugar sort of taste. That's nice. So put in maybe half a teaspoon. Work that together. And that's just to balance out the sweetness because of the water and the milk. Obviously they don't have any sugar or anything in. Here's the agar now. So that's gonna be ready. I'm giving the agar mix one more stir before I mix it together, just to smooth out. There's some lumps formed. Just wanna smooth those out a little bit. You can see I've got a little bit of sticking on the bottom of the pan, so I'd probably pay a bit more attention to it than I did. Mix that together. Well, that's a bit of a disaster, isn't it? I followed the recipe directions and it said take it off the heat and add the agar to the yogurt, and it started seizing. So I'd add the yogurt to the hot mix in the pan. So I'm gonna blend it. My confidence in this recipe has been a little bit shaken, and that amount of agar, I did wonder if it's a bit too less. So what I'm gonna do is put a bit in a dish and stick it in the freezer for a couple of minutes and just see how it sets. Because I might have to add more. So I'll just stick a small amount in the freezer and see what happens. The mark of a good panna cotta, in a traditional sense, when you use gelatin, it should have a very slight wobble, but it doesn't wanna be hard. It doesn't wanna be like, you know, Haribo. It just needs to have a very delicate wobble. It holds its shape as you cut into it with a spoon, but it shouldn't, you know, be ballistics gel. That's not what we're going for. So here's the grapefruit goo after probably, I don't know, 20 minutes, something like that. You can see a lot of the bubbles have gone, which is great. So let's have a look at the one from the freezer, see how that's set. Yeah, so that clearly hasn't worked at all. Right, need a new plan. I'm gonna have to add more agar. I'm gonna have to sieve this as well, because it's, even despite the blending, there's lots of little grainy, gritty bits. I think what I'm gonna do is sieve it in a nut milk bag, get the big pieces out, and then I'm gonna heat the yogurt before adding it into another agar mix. I'm gonna have to add more flavorings in now. Dollop this into the bag and try and squeeze it out. Oh, good grief. Got another 100 mils of water and 100 mils of soy milk. Unfortunately, I've got passion fruit powder and mango powder, and these are kind of dried fruits that's been powdered. So I'm gonna have to replace the flavor because I'm now putting more stuff in there, so the flavor's getting a bit muted. I'm doing another 3 teaspoons of agar. This now might go completely the other way. It might be that really hard set that I was talking about. With a teaspoon of mango powder and a teaspoon of passion fruit powder. Mix those together. I'm adding another 50 mils of milk or thereabouts. I'm just a little bit cautious now that that might be too much setting for that amount of liquid. Now we're gonna whisk the powders in. That back on the heat. This might be a massive problem because of those powders. I don't know if that's gonna affect the jelly. Heating up the yogurt, just so I don't get that same seizing again. I will get the blender out just in case. So the yogurt's now warmed through. I'm gonna mix in the agar. Okay, that's better. Test the set again, same time, same as I did last time. Put it in the fridge. This is the whisk that I had in that agar mix. And here is the set. So it's very, you know, hard. So hopefully there's enough yogurt that it's not going to do that. This has had just less than a minute of setting in the freezer. And it's looking good. Too hard. I did put too much agar. Should have done maybe one. So this is how it's looking. So it is more of a jelly than the very delicate panna cotta I hope for. But it tastes good. I'd perhaps do 2 teaspoons of agar in the first instance and then test the set, and that might be, yeah, that might be good. And then if not, you'll have to do all of that shenanigans that I did and start filling up the dishes. I'll let these cool down a bit more and then put them in the fridge to finish setting. And I'll see you back here when we start making the caviar. Hopefully that part's gonna go okay. The panna cottas have been resting in the fridge for about an hour, so I'm gonna get cracking with the pearls. I made a solution with 7 grams of the calcium lactate, stirred that into 700 grams of room temperature water, and then just made sure that there's no particles left, it's completely clear. And now, now I have to syringe it in droplets. I had a few coffee supporters who very kindly donated some money, and I bought a syringe with it. So I'm gonna try it out, see if that works. And if that doesn't work for any reason, I've got a syringe that I got from the vets for Cleo. Didn't use it for Cleo. You've been using it in the kitchen for other things. So I'll give it a try. Fill it up. This tastes really good. Pepper, vanilla, and rose water have just knocked it up to another totally different level. Very good. So the theory is you just drop it into the solution and it'll set into a, it'll become a little membrane on the outside. Not quite pearls, the more little, well, the little sperms, aren't they? I'm gonna take the needle off. See if that makes any difference. I'm gonna make a bit of room, fish some of these out. I'm gonna drop them into just fresh cold water. I'm gonna do a proof of concept for the spaghetti. So I want spaghetti kind of worked. It's not the perfect spheres I'd hoped for, but, you know, you get the general effect. I'm wondering if a squeezy bottle might be better. When I do the spaghetti, I might have to do a slightly stronger alginate solution, maybe 3%. Not sure. I don't know enough about the science. But I guess it's easy enough to experiment with. Got all my little, well, not quite spheres. I've got my little tadpoles. I'm gonna scoop them out onto a bit of cheesecloth just to try and drain it. Because I think if I put that on the plate, it's just not gonna be very nice. But they are very delicate, so they're losing their shape. Yeah, see, I'm just getting a pile of mush. I found a recipe and I kind of followed the instructions for that, but then when I was looking to see if you could do fruit puree, I saw something that said you can't, it doesn't work very well with high acid food, So I wonder if that's why it's not setting hard or hard enough. Yeah. It's just been back-to-back f***ing disaster, hasn't it? Mush on a plate it is. I'll see you back in a minute for the eating. So here's the panna cotta. Very hard. I think what I'm gonna do is blowtorch it out. See if that works. This is a mixture of ginger snap biscuits and toasted macadamia nuts, just to give a little bit of texture, a bit of extra flavour, you know, something a bit of excitement on there as well. Well, that hasn't worked at all either. Nope, knife it is. Kind of hold the paper underneath, try and pull some of that water out of it. You can hide any knife marks, that's okay. I'll have a dive into that, give it a go. Despite none of the textures quite working the way I wanted, apart from the biscuits, the flavour's great. The grapefruit goes nicely with that mango and passion fruit yogurt. It's quite a light dessert. And if you mix the biscuits and the nuts, that's gonna be fat-free. You know, if you get some fat-free yogurt. So quite a healthy one. Very light and refreshing, good for summer. So you can see, it is very hard. A panna cotta should just wibble and wobble a tiny bit. That is more like, I don't know, don't even know how to describe that. Like a very soft fudge. But, yeah, the flavour's banging. Despite it not being the delicately set, beautifully garnished with balls dessert that I hoped for, thank you very much, Coconut Collaborative, for my dessert. I very much appreciate that. For more recipe collaborations and to see that baked apple pie spaghetti, hit subscribe, tap the bell icon, and that way you won't miss any.